Welcome to a new test and teardown video. This time we're going to look at a Grundig UZ2400 Universal Counter. And it looks quite modern, but yet it is quite old. We got two different inputs and they got different frequency ranges. Let's look a little bit in the manual. That was super easy to find. Channel A handles from 10 Hz to 100 MHz. And the input divider can be selected between 1 or 10 on channel 1. If we look at channel C, it's a little bit funny why they call this channel C or not B, right? So that input, you got a fixed input divider of 100. So that means the frequency range is from 50 MHz to 2400 MHz. We got all the classic functions. We can test the internal 10 MHz frequency. And we can do, of course, frequency on A or frequency on C. We can do a period on A. And then we could do a pulse count on input A. And they talk about the time base, how accurate it is. And that is very interesting if that is really true. I would say that is very, very good. And they talk about 15 minutes of warm-up time. And they also say something about that it should use less than 20 watts. I found one on eBay just now. They say it is not tested. Or they cannot test it, but it boots up and it writes the frequency 10 MHz in the display. And they want $150 plus $70 shipping. So this is what is available right now if you want one of these. So before I go open it and test it, I was looking a little bit more here if I could probably find information about how old this one could be, but I don't see anything intelligent written on the label here. But there is a little reveal, probably the RS232C. They're using a 25 pin connector for that and not a 9 pin. So that tells me it is very much older than I think. I mean, if you look at the case, it's really nice and modern looking. So, yeah, I wouldn't think it would be that dingly that old. So I think we should go and try and play a little bit with this one. Clickety click. So how is it able to test its own frequency? I don't know. So let's start to give it 1.23456 MHz. And function should be frequency A. And then what? How do I make this happen? Aha! This is how I made it happen. And of course, we need to wait those 15 minutes, so I will be back. So, I think it was the 15 minutes that passed here. And as you see, this is 1 Hz and this is 0.1 Hz. And I think we have reached the limit of what this thing can do. I am now using gate time of 10 seconds. It can go all the way down to 10 microsecond of gate time. So that will be a very fast update. Why would you want to do that? But 10 or 1 second, and then we go to frequency A, and then we see a 1 hertz resolution. This should be a 7. But all in all, it is super, super accurate, especially in 10 second gate time. Wow. Let's play a little bit with input C. They say that it works from 50 megahertz. I just couldn't help it trying to see if that is really true. So that is 10 megahertz. Let's go for 20. Still a little bit weird going on here. So that is 30. Okay, and it works. So that means there is a lot of margin on the minimum frequency. And there you have it. This is the official minimum frequency for input C. And I bet we again have, okay, the same. So we could go to 10 second and then frequency C. I don't know if I need to push anything or just wait. What are we doing here? Okay, good. So it is for the patient. As we earlier found, is that we have a divider by 100 on input C. So that means with 1 hertz a gate time, we're gonna get 4 digits after megahertz, like that, right? If we want more than 4 digit, all we have to do is change the gate time to 10, then you're gonna get 1 more digit. But of course it's gonna take 10 seconds to get to your 10 hertz now resolution. I'm a little bit sad that I don't have a 100 second gate time, because then you could get 1 hertz resolution at 500 megahertz. This is just 500 that I'm testing with right now. And we also have, of course, room for another digit here that is needed, because it can go all the way to 2400. Oops, see? Now they added a colon here. So that means there is no, oops, and then it's gone. So this is while it's gating, and then when you have the result, it shows the colon. That is dumb. So that means it's gonna do something else when you give it a higher frequency. Anyway, let's try and open this thing. I'm not super happy about this case. Of course, they wanted to hide the screws, and they got these plastic screw hider clicky thingies. And the way that they lock, you need to push and bend and fight a lot. And already somebody was in here before me, so it's not entirely my fault that we got a little bit of scratch marks and stuff. So that means every time you go in here, you need to take these away and you need to add some more scratch marks. So that is not so good. Inside, we see that the inner plastic is coated with this red electrical conductive shielding. Look at that one. So they had to remove one of the little plastic, because there's the transformer. The temperature oven controlled oscillator here is, the whole unit is using about 15-16 watts at power up. And after about 10-15 minutes, the power usage drops to about 11 watts. So of course, the temperature regulator here is doing its thing. You can really feel that the oscillator is warm, but it is also shiny, so that means you can't really pick it up with a thermal camera. So I'm probably gonna add a little bit of paint to this one so I can show you what's going on. Here we got a voltage regulator. It's running at 63 Celsius, and the other one is running at 49. Oh yeah, the transformer is nice and cold. So all that is good. Meanwhile, I want to show you the inner workings of this fantastic unit. It's really, really beautifully made. The display is a standard 1 by 16, and it's LED backlit. Microcontroller is an 87C51, a classic C51 microcontroller. And we got some secret chips. They scratched away, filed away, dremeled away. Then two secret numbers, whatever that is, that we don't need to know here. And the newest IC is that one from 94. Just classic TTL circuits and all that. Not a big deal is going on here. So that is the low speed A input. And of course we have a little amplifier and a DC trig point set up here. And we have a we have a prescaler, so you can select times 1 or times 10 from the channel A. I don't really want to go in here. And that is a channel C input, and that goes to 2.4 gigahertz. And that input, we got two fast amplifiers located right there and there. And then you have a 100 times a prescaler, a divider, right? And that just goes into a frequency selector, multiplexer stuff. Probably that is another kind of counter stuff IC that is so sexy we don't need to know about it, right? Mains selection. That is also quite normal. Adding a little bit of paint makes the thermal camera works. Before you saw the capacitors shine on the top like they were ice cold, and that is of course because they were shiny. So now I made them less shiny. I tried to see if the paint here on the, but this type of shininess here is on the transformer wasn't really a thing. But now look at the oscillator. So that is the sticker and this is my paint. So there's definitely a big difference. Oh yeah, look down that hole. Oy, oy, oy. 40, 50 Celsius down the little hole here. So I bet that will be a frequency adjustment. I also found that this cable here there have a little funny wire that goes out here, but I think there's a shield around the output. So that is also a good thing what they're doing here. Yeah, that is running nice and warm too. Yeah, we can see that will be the two amplifiers. Aha, this is where they got the prescaler located. Let's look a little bit deeper inside this unit. This is channel A input, and we got a relay here where we select the, I think it is voltage range or something like that, because why would this be in the very front, right? And we got some amplifiers, classic analog amplifiers here, and look at that. This is an MC10216. So that is a triple line driver, or line receiver for that matter. And they go very, very fast, down in the nanoseconds. And I believe with all those resistors you see here around those two, they have feedbacked them so they can be used as amplifiers. And this way they can crank up the signal until it's a perfect square wave over the entire frequency range, Remember, this unit goes all the way from 10 hertz to 100 megahertz. So that is what I believe they're doing here. And a little last amplifier, and then we go to the counting stuff that we see over here. Normally, I do not remember anybody open oven-controlled oscillators. At least if they're working and if you're happy about it, please don't do this. I'm a professional, I can do this, and then I can show you what they contain, and that means you don't need to repeat any of this, right? So here's the bottom side of it. Nice, flexible ground connection to the chassis, right where the crystal is. So inside this potted little room here in the middle, we have a crystal, a heater, and a temperature sensor all connected really, really good together. And then it's, of course, electrically shielded, thermally shielded. Isn't that just lovely? But that is not all. Here we got the MAC-01. So a MAC-01 is a high precision 10.000 volt reference. It is a very, very good part. Even today, it is very, very good. 0.7 ppm Kelvin. And look at that temperature range of this part. That is definitely some good part. And up here, we have a voltage regulator. This is MAA723, the classic voltage regulator. And remember, the reference and the voltage regulator and all that stuff, the oscillator as well, is also inside a temperature controlled, regulated area. So that means the drift and the performance of everything here is going to be super, super stable. That was all I wanted to show you about this fantastic counter. There's only one tiny, tiny, tiny little suggestion what you can do if you have a counter like this, because it contains a reference that is that good. I really recommend you do this tiny little modification here. Down here in this area, see, you got plenty of space to drill a hole and put in a BNC connector. And then the cable could go here and you could put in a little amplifier. So you can take the output from the oscillator, it's normally mounted here, and then amplify, isolate, and then feed it out on an external output, because it is that good. I mean, it's stupid not to reuse it for something else. Okay, that was all. Thank you very much. Bye-bye. See you soon. Oh, there was something you wanted to add?
Oh yes, please like and subscribe.